Harumi, Japan, 1994. Nintendo's Iron Grip on the video game market is slipping. True competition is finally coming. As the lights dim on the 1994 Shoshinkai Software Exhibition, people wonder how Nintendo will hit back. But what the reveal was so weird that every journalist was just shocked and confused. On the sidelines, Nintendo rockstar Gunpei Yokoi stares and panics. How had the beautiful and novel idea he had turned into this? Just how could they have gone so wrong? Brought to you by my Nebula class. Usually, when I tell Nintendo stories, we start from Japan. But not today, because this story actually starts on the other side of the world. An engineer called Alan Becker was traveling on an airplane in 1985. This was years before laptops, handheld gaming machines, or smartphones, so if you wanted to keep yourself entertained in a plane, you basically had to read a book. But Alan had forgotten to bring a book, and in his boredom, he wondered about what kind of technology would be required for a device that allowed him to continue to work or be entertained during a flight. The closest thing to a laptop you could get at this time looked like this, and for handhelds, you had the Game & Watch. What was holding technology back? The very thing in front of you right now. Screens. Portable screens at the time were uncompromisingly terrible. They had ghosting, they were really expensive, and they used a lot of power. I have a way more detailed chronology of the liquid crystal display development on my original Game Boy video, since Nintendo engineers were also wrestling with these questions at the same time. But back in the airplane, Alan had an idea. His previous experience was on these flatbed scanners. If you ever succumbed to curiosity and opened it in the middle of the process, you might have figured this out. Scanners work by using LEDs to capture one line at a time, which was way cheaper than having a sensor capture the full page. And he figured he could reverse the process to create a screen. You have probably seen the same principle in some toys out there, where you have a single line of LEDs, but when moved really fast, they can generate a full image. Now, the only problem is that the only LEDs available in the market that were cheap enough for this project were red. This will mean that the display will only be able to show a red image in a black background. I'm sure this will not be a problem at all. 6 months later, he pieced together the first prototype and raised capital to form a company and make this product a reality. The company's name? Reflection Technology Inc. And this is when we meet Steve Lipsy. Hired as Vice President of Sales and Marketing, he's now part of the team tasked on finding a problem for the solution they already had. And this will take him on quite an unexpected journey. Fall 1988, Computex Dealers Exhibition in Vegas. The tech press is buzzing and hailing the private eye as the future of computer displays. Companies left and right are reaching out to make inquiries about this must-see gadget, and nearly 100 developer kits are sold on the show. But it was all for nothing. No one could figure out how to work around its limitations. No practical use ever materialized. Wow, a headset device that is meant to give something like a heads-up display that creates a lot of hype but never materializes into a product. Why does that sound so familiar? So with the idea dead in the water, it was time for the marketing team to find a new idea. And they will find inspiration in another trend that was sweeping tech media at the time. Virtual reality. Time is a flat circle, I know. It's the early 90s and everyone was hyped about the potential of virtual reality. Reflection saw its opportunity. Two private eyes attached to a welder's mask and a rudimentary head tracking device, plus a simple first-person tank fighting game running on a computer, made for a surprisingly affordable and capable VR headset. Before long, people in the office were lining up to play on the demo. Reflection's affordable technology made for an excellent video game device. If they wanted any chance to make it into the market, they will need to partner with someone different. Mattel and Hasbro had both rejected the project, so they figured this was a device more appropriate for a video game company. Hopes were high as Lipsy and the marketing team walked into the Sega of America headquarters for a pitch. But Sega of America's president Tom Kalinske was not charmed. Sega was reviewing VR technology for a planned VR headset for the Sega Genesis, with Sega in full marketing swing with the Game Gear, trashing the Game Boy for its monochromatic screen. They could not just go and release this device, they will be laughed out by their own customers. Nope, they will have to take a pass on this. The options for companies to partner with was shrinking, but Lipsy had one last card to play. His contact in Japan had managed to set up one final meeting with the big boy of video games, Nintendo themselves. Before the visit, Lipsy could feel the mounting pressure of the meeting. This was during the time when Nintendo was the undisputed king of the game world and one of the biggest companies in Japan. He wondered and feared if they could find issues with his monochromatic device. But doubts started to melt as he watched a particularly eager Nintendo engineer absolutely lose his mind at the tank demo. "Wow, you really seem to like it. Excuse me, I did not catch your name. Who are you?" "The name is Yokoi. Gunpei Yokoi." For those who have not been following up with my Game Boy saga, here's a very quick summary on why this was important. Gunpei Yokoi was, at the time, one of the biggest product development stars at Nintendo, who had fought the entire company to make the original Game Boy using a monochromatic screen, which did become an enormous success for the company. However, the amount of drama, strife, and conflict involving the Game Boy's tumultuous development had left him deeply disappointed in the direction Nintendo was taking, and he had put a secret plan in motion to retire from the company so he could do his own thing. The plan involved introducing more hit products so he could leave the company with his head high. And during this demo, he realized an opportunity for retirement had just walked into the door. Recalling the uphill battle that was convincing the company to go for the limited screen of the Game Boy, he was not intimidated by the device's limited color palette. He felt darkness made it up by totally immersing players in a way never before possible. As Nintendo executives meet to accept or reject Lipsy's pitch, his nerves continue to rise. He might have won the approval of Yokoi, but on the other side of the table sat an intimidating man, none other than Nintendo president and resident business maverick Hiroshi Yamauchi. As Lipsy continues with his presentation, the lack of reaction from Yamauchi begins to concern him. Man, this guy, he is unreadable, truly a colossus among Japanese businessmen, perfectly trained not to give away any leverage. His expression so still that you will almost imagine he was not in this meeting at all. Did he just fall asleep? Well, the president of the company falling asleep in the middle of a presentation seemed like a pretty big red flag. It seemed that Yamauchi had long decided to leave this in the hands of his subordinates and give Yokoi, who had so far not delivered a bad product, whatever he wanted. Or maybe he was just bored out of his mind. Yamauchi's actions are often confusing to understand. After the meeting, Nintendo paid $10 million in advance royalties, both a minority stake in Reflection Technologies and both the exclusive license for this technology in video games. Yokoi had been given the go-ahead to create his last hit product. His vision was of a wearable standalone headset running an efficient, low-wattage 32-bit RISC processor that would allow players to immerse themselves completely in games, all wrapped up in a catchy name, the Virtual Boy. The portability of a Game Boy with virtual reality capabilities, a concept that sounds shockingly familiar. While Yokoi's philosophy was usually one of reusing well-understood technology to great effect, this time he had given himself some room to dream of the future. But soon enough, the limitations of the present came back to haunt him. Nowadays, wireless always online gadgets attached to every part of our bodies are a fact of life, but back in the mid-90s, there were serious concerns about the effects of radio frequency radiation on the body, and Nintendo engineers were concerned about selling a device chock full of radiation-emitting chips on kids' heads. Deciding to play it safe, a metal plate was added on top of the CPU to block all radiation, but this made the device so heavy that it was difficult to strap to the head. Maybe they should have just wrapped their heads in tinfoil, clearly. Untethered, Yokoi came up with a shoulder device that will allow the heavier headset. But this idea stirred something deep in Nintendo's offices and awoke an ancient evil from the darkness. Nintendo's legal department. You see, Japan was about to introduce a law that will make companies very liable for accidents that could happen because of a product. On one hand, experts hired by Nintendo had determined that the 3D technology was harmless to the eye, except in the very specific case of young children if the lenses had any significant vertical misalignment. While vertical misalignments on this rigid device was nearly impossible, the legal team panicked at the idea of Nintendo being liable for any damage and advised towards covering the manuals with warnings and disclaimers of the potential dangers of the device, and went as far as to enforce a 15-minute timer that constantly reminded users to take a break. But the worst part was the mere idea of a kid walking around with one of these devices completely blind to the world. It was terrifying. What if a kid will fall down the stairs while walking? Can you imagine the headlines? The lawsuits?
Won't somebody please think of the children?
This will not do. Guided by the legal department, the device lost its wearable qualities and became a device mounted on a stand. All vestiges of the original virtual reality design lost. And at this point, alarms were going off in Yokoi's head. With the device losing all semblance of its original portable design, everyone will compare it with the consoles rather than handhelds. He had seen what their rival console division was developing, a 64-bit console capable of really impressive 3D graphics. If the Virtual Boy was compared side by side to this, he was going to be in trouble. But he had the support of President Yamauchi, who had led him to run the project in the first place, and he hoped he still had enough favor to ask him to delay the project just enough so he could accommodate for the new design. 1994, as Hiroshi Yamauchi reads the company's reports, he was restless. Longtime rival Sega was about to launch their next-gen console, a device capable of impressive 3D graphics, and Sony had been so pissed off about Nintendo breaking their relationship that they were about to enter the market with their own console. Nintendo was originally ready to respond with their own 3D-capable hardware, until the console team had hit major development snags that delayed the project, potentially giving Nintendo's enemies years to establish themselves in the 3D market before Nintendo could make its move. He needed something, anything that Nintendo could market quickly to at least hold some place in the 3D market.
Excuse me, Yamauchi-san!
Huh, so that's how that feels.
Sir, I have come to talk about the Virtual Boy's release date. Yokoi, you genius! I need you to release that 3D-capable console immediately!
Immediately? But I wanted to redesign the hardware. I haven't even talked to Miyamoto about games.
Miyamoto's very busy with some 3D Mario thing. Look, your team can make games, right? Make some!
As the Virtual Boy was finally shown to the public at the 1994 Shoshinkai Software Exhibition in Harumi, Japan, the public was confused. Just as Yokoi had feared, the project had divagated so far from its original intention that the name Virtual Boy was more confusing than exciting, as reporters wonder why this was being passed as a virtual reality device. The Rush game lineup and particularly the high price in the ballpark of more exciting 3D consoles meant that the device was set for a rough launch. Still, given Nintendo's game design reputation, some wonder if, given enough time, hit games will materialize for the system. But all hope vanished when the device manuals, filled with the warnings that the legal department had required, leaked to the press, which quickly created a narrative about this device being something that will destroy a player's eyes. 5 months after release, the platform was officially discontinued in Japan, and Nintendo quickly tried to move on to the Nintendo 64 and forget the Virtual Boy ever happened. In fact, if it weren't for the brilliant journalistic work of people like Benji Edwards at Fast Company, most of these details would be lost to history, as it remains the worst commercial failure of all Nintendo platforms. Yokoi's retirement will have to wait. He was burned from the experience and will have to try again to make one last product. Don't worry, he and Nintendo will be fine. He will eventually find the heat he needed on the Game Boy Pocket, a story with quite its own twists and turns, which I already made a video about. The ones that were not as lucky were the people at Reflection Technology. For the next few years, they work on a color version of their displays, hoping to learn from the mistakes of the Virtual Boy, but they ran out of capital and faded into obscurity. Was the Virtual Boy simply an incomplete product? Or was it underappreciated? Were both Nintendo and Reflection Technologies aiming at ideas that were just not possible at the time and that will take decades to make possible? The world might never know. What we actually know is that this was not Nintendo's first attempt at doing a 3D headset. There was another, much earlier attempt that will actually start a series of events that will lead to the first meeting of some legends that would change the course of Nintendo and video game history forever. So that is the story that I will tell this time in SideQuest, my companion series of side stories that I make for these videos, which you can find in my streaming service, Nebula, which just got way better because I finally get to tell you about an unexpected adventure I had to keep secret until now. Last Christmas, I traveled to New York. I met with a pro team to record a spectacular looking, nearly hour long class on how to produce a high end video on a low spec budget.
Honestly, I do all of this with a relatively healthy work schedule. Well, at least the healthiest I have had in a while.
And all of this is part of the next big step in empowering independent creators, Nebula Classes. A new addition to the Nebula family and the result of a titanic amount of work from creators and every person on the Nebula team to just produce the best, most interesting stuff out there. New classes are coming out regularly, and right now you can not only enjoy Mac class, but other amazing content like Legal Eagles class and How to Sue People Like a Lawyer, which is one of the most engrossing things I've watched in a while, or How to Be Ready for Your Dream Job, a class by Matt from Extra Credits on the process he took from an MTV producer to the showrunner of one of the most iconic channels out there, and what lessons this can teach about creating opportunities. Nebula classes come with a promotional price right now through the link in the description or the button about to appear on your screen, which includes a Nebula subscription with access to all our exclusive content. And we have a special upgrade price to all of you that already have a Nebula subscription through CuriosityStream. It is thanks to you and your support that more than 100 independent creators are building the very first creator-owned successful streaming platform. Thank you for signing up and allowing us to raise the bar on things that independent creators can do.